Good morning. Today I want to talk in general terms about the meaning of mystical theology. Or you could give my talk a subtitle, The Nearness Yet Otherness of God. Now, to understand what mystical theology signifies for the Orthodox East, let me begin with three passages. The first is quite long, the second is shorter, and the third is shorter still. My first passage comes from St. Gregory of Nyssa, writing in the late 4th century. It comes in his commentary on the book Ecclesiastes. Imagine, he says, someone who finds himself on a mountain ridge. He is at the top of a sheer, steep crag, extending downwards into a bottomless abyss. Now imagine what this person would probably experience if he put his foot on the edge of this cliff which overlooks the chasm and found below no solid footing and nothing to hold on to. This is what I think the soul experiences when it goes beyond its footing in material things, in its quest for that which has no dimension and which exists from all eternity. For here there is nothing it can take hold of, neither place nor time, neither measure nor anything else. It does not allow our minds to approach. And thus the soul, slipping at every point from what cannot be grasped, becomes dizzy and perplexed, and returns again to what is co-natural to it, content now to know merely this about the transcendent, that it is completely different from the nature of the things that the soul knows. Now, here St. Gregory of Nyssa is describing, through the vivid image of somebody who finds himself suddenly on the edge of a precipice, he's describing the effect of leaving the realm of sense perception and meeting the eternal. When this happens, we undergo a feeling of vertigo and dizziness. We are taken out of ourselves. We reach out into the unknown. We lose all familiar footholds. We find ourselves spiritually on the edge of an abyss, and so we feel awe and wonder. The German theologian Otto described this in the phrase Mysterium tremendum et fascinans, the mystery that makes us tremble and yet attract. So then, Gregory is trying to underline here the awareness of mystery, the gap between the created world and the Creator. The transcendent, he says, is completely different from the nature of the things that the soul knows. So that is one aspect of what we are talking about when we speak of mystical theology. Now let me take a second passage, and this comes from St. Simeon, the new theologian, who is writing in the early 11th century. Imagine someone standing at night inside his house with all the doors closed. And then suppose that he opens a window just at the moment when there is a sudden flash of lightning. Unable to bear its brightness, at once he protects himself by closing his eyes and drawing back from the window. So it is with the soul that is enclosed in the realm of the senses. If ever she peeps out through the window of the mind, she is overwhelmed by the brightness like lightning of the pledge of the Holy Spirit within her. Unable to bear the splendor of unveiled light, at once she is bewildered in her mind, and she draws back entirely on herself, taking refuge as in a house among sensory and human things. Now there again, like St. Gregory of Nyssa, St. Simeon is describing the effect of transcending the world of sense perception. And in common with Gregory of Nyssa, he is underlining our awareness of the otherness of the divine. A sense of mystery. Through the image of a sudden flash of lightning, he indicates the utter disproportion between our capacities and the reality that confronts us. We are blinded by a superabundance of light. We experience the light as darkness. A sudden flash of lightning. It's significant that Simeon underlines the suddenness of this experience of the transcendent. And it's the same with Gregory of Nyssa. Suddenly we're on the edge of a precipice. The experience that Simeon is describing is not the result of our own efforts. It's something that happens to us. But notice an interesting shift in Simeon's imagery. He begins by talking about looking through a window and seeing outside us a sudden flash of light. But then he speaks of the pledge of the Holy Spirit that is within us. So he shifts from outside to inside. This experience of the otherness of God is not just something that we experience at a distance, something going on far beyond us, but it is also an experience of something that is within us. An experience, yes, of the transcendence of God, but equally an experience of the divine indwelling. So, that shift is rather important, from the outside to the inside. And here is my third preliminary text, once more from St. Simeon, the new theologian. As a friend talking with his friend, we speak with God, and drawing near in confidence, we stand before the face of him who dwells in light unapproachable. Now, in my first two texts about the sudden abyss before our feet when we're on the mountain ridge, and about the flash of lightning, the emphasis is primarily on the otherness of God. Wonder, mystery, transcendence. And this also is stressed in my third text, because Simeon talks about God dwelling in light unapproachable. That's a quotation from 1 Timothy 6:16. But Simeon, in my third text, equally is stressing the nearness of God. As a friend speaking with a friend, God is not simply transcendent. He is the friend who is closer to us than our own heart. And he enters into dialogue with us. We draw near in confidence to him. There is not simply otherness, but nearness. Not simply transcendence, but a union in love. Now, in those three texts, we can discern the fundamental contrast, if you like, the antinomy or paradox that lies at the heart of all mystical theology, Eastern or Western, Christian or non-Christian. And this is the contrast between, on the one side, the otherness of God, the divine transcendence, the sense of mystery, of wonder, the realization that God is utterly different from all the objects round us. And then, on the other side, there is the experience of the nearness of God, the experience of unity with God, a union in love. These are the two poles, contrasting but not contradictory, in our mystical theology. The nearness yet otherness of the eternal. We have a sense that God is utterly beyond and above the things that we know. But we have a sense also that God is uniquely close to us, that God dwells within us. The kingdom of heaven is within you. Luke 17:21. Now, these two poles, otherness yet nearness, are joined together by St. Athanasius of Alexandria in a famous phrase. This is from his work on the Incarnation, chapter 54. He is speaking of the divine Logos, the Word of God, Christ. He became man that we might become God. Or he became human that we might become divine. He was incarnate that we might be ingodded. Now, in the phrase, he became man, we have the basic theme of Christology and of Trinitarian theology. In the phrase, that we might become God, we have the basic theme of mystical theology. But significantly, St. Athanasius joins these two into a single sentence. In fact, there's no separation. We shouldn't split theology up into watertight compartments. Everything ties up with everything else. The great Russian theologian of the beginning of the 20th century, Father Pavel Florensky, used to say it's so difficult to write or speak about theology, because you want to say everything at once, and yet you can't do that. So, in mystical theology, we want to say everything at once. God is Holy Trinity. One of the Trinity became human. And through the Incarnation and the cross and the resurrection, the path has been opened to us, to the divine realm. We can become God. Not, of course, in the literal sense of becoming additional members of the Trinity, but we can share directly in the divine grace and glory We can become, as is said in 2 Peter 1:4, partakers of the divine nature. So we attain divinization or deification, in Greek theosis. Christianity is not just holding certain theories about God, it's not a philosophical system only. Christianity is not a question just of moral imitation, of keeping ethical rules. Christianity signifies a direct participation through grace in the life of God. We can say, in a full and literal sense, His life is mine. That's the title of a book by a great spiritual teacher of the 20th century, the Russian monk Father Sofroni. His life is mine. So this is what mystical theology is about. First, about the divine transcendence, but secondly about the way in which through the incarnation we can approach the divine mystery and share in the life of God. That then is a general outline of what I mean by mystical theology. And now I'd like to set before you a map of the spiritual journey, of the way in which we can approach the divine mystery. And this is a map with three stages or steps, three levels, because it's probably not successive stages but deepening levels that we should be thinking about. And this threefold map of the spiritual life is to be found first of all in Origen in the 3rd century, in his commentary and homilies on the Song of Songs. Then it's taken up in the 4th century by Evagrius of Pontus, who died about 399. He was a disciple of the Cappadocian fathers of St. Basil the Great and St. Gregory of Nazianzus, Gregory the theologian, and then he went off to be a monk in the desert of Nitria in Egypt. And this threefold pattern then comes in very many other writers, for example in St. Maximus the Confessor in the 7th century. Now, Origen draws a basic contrast between action and contemplation, between Martha and Mary. But he then subdivides contemplation into 2 stages. There is first the contemplation of nature, or natural contemplation, what Origen calls physics, and then there is the contemplation of God, vision of God and union with Him. Now let's look at this threefold scheme. First then you have action, in Greek praxis or praktiki, the active life. And this doesn't primarily mean your external situation. It doesn't mean going out to be a school teacher or a nurse or a missionary. The Greek fathers are not talking about external situation, they're talking about inner state. So the active life means the life of moral effort, the struggle to overcome negative thoughts and to acquire the virtues. Then you have stage two, the contemplation of nature, or natural contemplation. This means not the direct vision of God, but it means understanding the world as a sacrament of the divine presence, treating visible and material things as a ladder of ascent through the creation. Through the creation we mount up towards the Creator. So natural contemplation, or the contemplation of nature, origins, physics, is not exactly what Einstein had in mind, but it is to see God in all things, and all things in God. We may recall here the poem of the 17th century, George Herbert, The Elixir. Teach me, my God and King, in all things thee to see, and what I do in anything, to do it as for thee. So, natural contemplation is to find God everywhere. As Father Alexander Schmemann says, the end of his wonderful book For the Life of the World, the Christian is the one who, wherever he or she looks, sees everywhere Christ and rejoices in him. Natural contemplation means find God everywhere. Among the sayings attributed to Christ, though not to be discovered in the canonical Gospels, there is this one. It comes in the apocryphal Gospel of Thomas, but perhaps it is a genuine saying of our Lord. Lift the stone, and you will find me. Cut the wood in two, and there am I. So this is the first stage of the contemplative life, to treat the world as a sacrament of the divine presence, to find Christ in all things and in all persons, to discover first the value of each thing and each person in their distinctive uniqueness, and then to discover how each thing and each person point beyond themselves towards God. Each thing, each person are to be experienced in the utmost sharp, distinctive relief, but at the same time, each thing or person is to become transparent so that we see God within them. Find Christ everywhere. And then you have the third stage, the contemplation of God, the experience of union with Him. Above all images, above all thoughts, above all concepts and discursive thinking. The vision of God that we find described in the works of the mystics, both Eastern and Western. An experience of transcendent union. An experience where we no longer think of God as an object over there, or a subject over there, but we experience Christ in me, I in Christ. As Paul says in Galatians 2:20, not I, but Christ in me. An experience where we are no longer conscious of separation from God, but of union with Him. Experience of all-embracing unity, in which our personhood, our created human personhood, is not abolished, but it's taken up in the abyss of divine love, so that we no longer feel ourselves separate from God. As T.S. Eliot says, you are the music while the music lasts. Now, that third stage of direct union with God, even for the saints, is in most cases something that only happened to them at rare intervals, perhaps just once or twice in their life. And for very many of us, sinners that we are, we feel it's far beyond us. But that does not mean we are unable to be contemplatives, because the second stage of the three stages I've mentioned, the contemplation of nature, is something very accessible within the reach of every one of us. We just need to say, stop. Look and listen. Be present where you are. Dwell in the here and now. Eternity is not just in the future. Eternity is hidden in each moment of time. God is not just far away. In and through the Holy Spirit, He is very close. And all of us, I think, can attain this apprehension of the way in which the present moment opens out on eternity, of the way in which infinity is contained in each grain of sand. So, natural contemplation is something very accessible. All of us can be contemplatives. This is the deep conviction of the Christian East. Contemplatives are not some elite, some special class marked out from everyone else. The roots of contemplation lie in the heart of every one of us. The best is for everyone. That is the deep conviction of mystical theology. So, even if the direct vision of God, which is a gift of grace, may seem a very long way from our present immediate experience, yet to touch God in the world round us, that we can all do. So contemplation extends very high, but it starts here and now, where you and I are at this very moment. So there is my threefold map. The active life, the struggle to acquire virtue, the practice of the ascetic life, understanding asceticism to mean not just fasting and sleeping on the ground and making prostrations, but asceticism means every aspect of our effort, aided by divine grace, to follow the path of Christ. Then the second level, the contemplation of God in nature, leading on, perhaps for all of us there are glimpses of this, to the direct apprehension of God. Those are the three stages, and they aren't successive in the sense that one stops where the next begins, because the beginning of the active life is repentance, but we must go on repenting to the end of our life. We never pass beyond repentance, we never pass beyond the first step. So it's not a question of successive stages so much as deepening levels. Even those who receive the vision of God, as Isaiah did when he saw God lifted high on his throne and the cherubim and seraphim crying out, "Holy, holy, holy." Isaiah's first reaction to this was to say, "I am dust and ashes." So when he had a vision of God, his first reaction was renewed repentance. So it's not a question of leaving behind the earlier stages, but of deepening levels. We go on repenting, but at the same time we embark on the vision of God, the path of contemplation. Now, let me speak next of two primary symbols of God in our mystical theology. And these are light and darkness. In the passages that we looked at the beginning, the two passages from St. Simeon, the New Theologian, the language of light is applied to God. Simeon experiences God as a flash of lightning, as the one who dwells in light unapproachable. But other mystical writers experience God as darkness. And these two symbols are not opposed to each other. They're not mutually exclusive. We need to work with both of them. This is the great advantage of symbols, that you don't have to say either or, as you tend to do in logical arguments, but you can say both and. Now, these two symbols of God as light and God as darkness come already in Holy Scripture. They come, for example, in the account of Moses going up Mount Sinai. And this has always been understood in mystical theology as one of the key moments of the divine encounter, a paradigm of mystical union. So we have two kinds of passage in Exodus about Moses' ascent of Sinai. First of all, we have Exodus 24, verses 9 to 11. "Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw the place where the God of Israel stood. And there was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire, and as it were the appearance of the firmament of heaven in its purity. And of the chosen ones of Israel, there was not so much as one missing. And they appeared in the place of God, and did eat and drink." There the imagery is of light, purity, clarity, the sapphire stone, the firmament of heaven. Though it is not actually said that they saw God, it's only said that they saw the place of God. So the divine mystery is still hedged round. But you have equally in Exodus the use of darkness imagery. We are told Exodus 20:21, a key text in Eastern Christian mystical theology. Moses entered into the darkness where God was. It isn't said there that God is darkness, but merely that darkness is his dwelling place. As it says in Psalm 18, you have made darkness your dwelling place. Two contrasting symbols then for the mystical union, light and darkness. In the New Testament, we only find the symbolism of light for God. Particularly in the first epistle of John, 1 John 1:5. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. And equally in the text we've mentioned, 1 Timothy 6:16, God dwells in light unapproachable. When, however, we turn to the Christian tradition subsequently, we find both the symbols of light and of darkness used. For example, in the pre-Christian period, in Platonism, God is thought of as light, as the spiritual sun. That is an image used by Plato in the Republic. Plotinus, the Neoplatonist philosopher of the 3rd century, certainly had visions of divine light, and indeed occasions when he was transformed into light. You don't find in Platonism the imagery of divine darkness. But when we turn to the Jewish writer Philo, of the 1st century AD, who has a profound influence on the Christian mystical tradition, Philo speaks of God as darkness, drawing on Exodus 20:21. So the notion of God as darkness, or dwelling in darkness, is something that comes not from the Hellenic Platonist tradition, but from Judaism. When we move into the Christian period, in the late 2nd, early 3rd century, Saint Clement of Alexandria takes up Philo, and he uses the symbol of darkness for God. And darkness here signifies not any lack or privation in God, but it signifies that God is mystery, utterly beyond our understanding, the divine abyss of which Gregory of Nyssa speaks. But then Origen, who was in Alexandria a little after Clement, who was often closely linked with Clement, on this point differs from him. Origen makes very little use of the symbol of divine darkness. He has little to say about Exodus 20:21, his commentary on the Pentateuch. He speaks of God as light. And so in the 4th century does Gregory the theologian, Gregory of Nazianzus. But then Gregory of Nyssa, closely associated with Gregory of Nazianzus, brings back the image of God as divine darkness, expressing in this way the utter mystery of God. But Gregory speaks of God as dazzling darkness. So see, he combines here the two images of light and darkness. As it says in Psalm 139, With thee the darkness and light are both alike. So there is a coincidence of opposites here. Jung loved to talk about a coincidentia oppositorum, but you got that already long before in people like Gregory of Nyssa. The darkness is supremely bright. And that is also the case with the author who goes under the name of Dionysius the Areopagite, who was not in fact a disciple of St. Paul, but lived probably in Syria around 500 AD. And he talks about the ray of divine darkness, which outshines the brightest light. And he talks about a darkness that is supremely bright. The darkness really is not in God, it's in us. God is so bright, so far surpassing all our personal experience, so far beyond everything else that we know, that we are blinded by this light. The 17th century mystical writer Jacob Burma says, "The darkness is nothing else but the terror that comes from the blinding light." So, in this way, we have two symbols confirming and complementing each other, not contradicting each other. Light and darkness as ways of expressing the supreme mystery of union with God. And they are only symbols, because God is not light and God is not darkness. He is far above and beyond these things. But light and darkness are significant symbols pointing towards God. Thanks.